I'm Corey Johnson. Digital currency Ripple breaking out of Bitcoin shadow. It's value exploded over the last week, really over the last year. It is in the leading cryptocurrency of the entire year. Really stunning stuff. Brad Garlinghouse, CEO of Ripple, joins me now from New York. Brad, always a pleasure to talk to you, and I've said that for years talking to you. I didn't have any idea that Ripple was going to become the kind of thing that it has become here. And it's interesting to me because you're so focused on having a functioning business built around blockchain, but you've also got this big honking valuable currency that you guys have a lot of.
There's no question, and I think as some of your earlier participants, said, there's a lot of hype in this space, but I think there's also a lot of reality. And Ripple's been very focused on how do we create real utility and solve a real problem. And in this case, it's for cross-border payments, which is a multi-trillion-dollar problem. And if we could reduce the friction there using blockchain technologies, we think we can create a lot of value for consumers, for banks, for the whole ecosystem.
Yeah, I mean, the whole thing of going to an ATM, anyone who travels overseas and goes to an ATM machine and sees the massive fees slapped on there just to access their own money, often from the same bank that they use for in their native country, knows what a problem this is, let alone the huge businesses that Western Union and others have moving currency. But it looks like you're looking far beyond that, I guess, into actually what the banks themselves are paying.
You know, even within the banking community, there's a few banks that kind of sit on the top of the entire global payments infrastructure. And all the other banks end up paying them to help settle the global liquidity that's required for commerce, for small businesses, for retail. And across the board, it's kind of amazing that we still live in a world where to send money to London today, the fastest thing for you or I to do would be to drive to, well, for you, for SFO, for me here in New York, to JFK or Newark, and fly the money to London. That's crazy. We live in the age of the internet, and we can't move our own money in real time. And of course, as you said, the costs here can be really high.
Yeah, it's a fascinating thing. It seems like the kind of thing I love when you talk about this, saying it should be as easy as sending an email or moving any other piece of digital information, downloading a website or whatever. When you make the sale for this business, to whom do you make the sale?
Well, we really are in the business of selling solutions, selling technology to banks. Part of that is simply a software sale. And part of that also for customers that want to take advantage of using a digital asset like XRP for liquidity. What that means is instead of pre-funding literally the trillions of dollars that banks have with other banks around the world, they pre-fund that amount that sits there. It's really dormant cash sitting there. With digital assets, you can make that much more real time to enable a payment across a border into another currency in real time. Today, Ripple's doing that into Mexico with companies like Qualix, and we certainly see that expanding with other partners and customers over time.
How much money is pre-funded and how long does it typically sit there?
There's $27 trillion sitting in these bank-to-bank accounts. They're called Nostra accounts, Vostra accounts.
Yeah.
The bilateral relationship between the Bank of Corey and the Bank of Brad. You can put as much money as you want with the Bank of Brad.
Brad, I want to make the same invitation to you. Since it's the holidays, since we've been friends for a long time, you can put as much as you want in the Bank of Corey.
It's a problem I appreciate that. It really is a problem that if we can reduce the time, the friction, the cost, we really can accelerate global commerce. And by reducing that friction, you accelerate that engine. It's good across the board. It's good for both companies in the United States. It's good for the unbanked communities across Africa. It really can fundamentally change the way the global financial infrastructure is wired.
Explain the unbanked. The issue of the unbanked is such a fascinating thing that first worlders don't really think about much. I certainly don't. But explain how that helps.
Well, if you think about it today, banks want to serve customers as long as they can serve them profitably. If they can't serve a customer profitably, they're not going to do it. So when you talk about a migrant workforce, for example, in Africa, that is not obviously making a lot of money and is taking that money from country to country, the cost of using the banking system would actually exceed the income that they would have. If we can reduce the friction globally and make it easier for that migrant worker to hold assets, to move those assets without costing them lots of money, they then become part of the banking, the kind of global financial community. I think that, when we think about an internet of value, and Ripple's long-term kind of 10-year vision is, how do we enable an internet of value? How do we enable value to move the way information moves today, as you referred to email as an example? It's really bringing those communities into the system and allowing them to participate and benefit from being a part of that financial system.
I said email because I'm old. I should have said text messages or
snaps
or something. But Brad, I want to take you into the Bloomberg terminal. I think you've seen this. I sent you guys a screenshot earlier this week or a few weeks ago. When we created this monitor of cryptocurrencies on the Bloomberg, we listened to the prices of these cryptocurrencies. And look, lo and behold, number two right there, just because we picked it to be number two, is Ripple. And when I look at what that has done over the last year, holy cow, look at that gain. That's a stunning gain for anything, particularly in the last few weeks, as we pointed out earlier. But that price right now of a $1.23, we'll call it, how many coins or how many XRPs does Ripple own right now?
Ripple owns 61% of it. There's 100 billion units of XRP that are created. We own about 61% of them. I think there's no doubt 2017 has been, amongst other things, the year of crypto. And within the year of crypto, XRP has outperformed every other digital asset out there. So year to date, as that chart showed, we're up about 20,000%. If you ask why
is that? Also, that gives you about $75 billion worth of coin right now?
That gives us a huge strategic asset to go invest in and accelerate the vision we see for an internet of value that I was describing earlier. For me, this is all about an opportunity to participate and accelerate a vision we've had for some time. I think the reason why there's been excitement around XRP, there's been excitement around digital assets broadly, XRP specifically, because people have increasingly realized that we have real customers, we have the best performing technology.
Right.
I know you have actually talked about this, but to complete a Bitcoin transaction takes about $40 and the transaction cost.
And it's slow.
And it takes several hours on average. In contrast, XRP is very efficient. It settles in about three to four seconds and costs fractions of a penny. So while I think there are lots of use cases and utility you can have from Bitcoin, it's right. not going to be a payment solution in its current form. I think it's a store of value. I'm long Bitcoin. I think there's value there. But I think when you talk about lots of other use cases and all of these digital assets, I think it comes back to what's the utility? What's the problem that's being solved? And are there real customers that can take advantage of that?
But if you're sitting on $75 billion worth of an asset, do you envision a scenario over the next year where you'll sell any of that?
Well, certainly we use some of it day by day and week by week to invest in the ecosystem. So we use, in December, we actually publicly produce a quarterly market report talking about what's going on in the XRP markets. And we sell a little bit with market makers to incentivize market makers. We want to make sure we have very tight liquidity between XRP and not other digital currencies, but fiat. So we want to go into, as I was describing earlier, into the Mexican peso. We want tight spreads between the Mexican peso and XRP and other currencies. So we work with market makers globally. We work with exchanges globally to make sure that there's very good liquidity to deliver on that.
Brad Garlinghouse, CEO of Ripple. Always enjoy our conversation. This is a really fascinating one, so thanks for your time.
Thanks, Corey.
Well, you can deposit my
developer Ripple's XRP token has surged more than 500% this year. Brad, nice to have you here.
Thanks for having me.
First of all, just tell people what exactly Ripple does, because it's not just the currency, also you're very involved in blockchain.
Absolutely. So Ripple sells a blockchain technology to banks and payment providers and other financial institutions to do real-time settlement between banks. So today, if Morgan wanted to send $10,000 to London right now, the fastest way for her to do that is to drive to Newark or JFK and fly it there. Our view is, in a world of the internet, you can stream video from the space station, you should be able to do real-time settlement between banks, and we sell technology to banks to do that.
And the banks are getting on board with this because they know there's a lot of paper pushing and also a lot of money attached to those settlements.
For sure. So we have over 100 banks working with Ripple today around the world. I think the vast majority of banks, like 99.9% of banks, actually are paying other banks, the global money center banks like JP Morgan or Citibank, to make those settlements. So a lot of the banks are very excited about democratizing how these global payments flow.
There's a belief that, you could transform the global payment system over time. Although then the alternative argument is you need a centralized, you can't have it decentralized, that it actually benefits from efficiencies. I would assume you come down in the ladder.
Yeah, for sure. I think any time you can do something without that central counterparty, you're going to reduce friction, which is measured by time, cost, speed. So by removing that central counterparty and going direct from point to point, you can skip going from the Bank of David to the Bank of Morgan to the Bank of Mike. You just go directly to the Bank of Mike.
So if the immediate opportunity is efficiencies in this area of the actual kind of nuts and bolts sort of plumbing of the financial system, how does that relate to the value of the Ripple tokens or of the Bitcoin or cryptocurrencies? They're taking on a separate life, it seems, from the future of adoption of this technology.
It's a great point, and I think one of the things we all have to remember is that the value of a token over the long term is really going to be derived by its utility. What problem is it solving? How big is that problem? How many customers do you have? there's no question there's a lot of hype in this system, and I don't actually think that's a good thing. For Ripple, we use this digital asset called XRP to settle liquidity needs between banks. So today, there's $27 trillion parked at different banks around the world so they can make payments between each other. Our view is you can use a digital asset like XRP to do that in real time. Because XRP has been so efficient, it settles a transaction about 3 seconds compared to Bitcoin.
So it just passes through that currency for that period of time.
That's correct. Yeah.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.